first question would be that given the new, you know, the new judgment, or first of all, let me even get your view. Let me get your view on the judgment. What's your opinion? What's your general view on the judgment yesterday? What do you think of it, you know, from your own personal opinion?
All right. Thanks for inviting me. The excitement over that judgment is totally uncalled for. I don't think there's any need for people to get excited. And I think it's on the side of surplusage that the Supreme Court had to take that step to give that decision. Because these are things that are well established in the Constitution. The Constitution on local government autonomy and local government democratization are very straightforward. It is simply that people want to defy it. And that principle that's established in that yesterday's case, which people consider as landmark, is already that's been established long ago in a plethora of cases delivered by the Supreme Court, judgments delivered by the Supreme Court. The Attorney General Abia against Attorney General Federation on the fact that the local government system must be democratized at all times, must be established under democratic norms and run as a democratic system. It flows directly from the democratization of the country, which was effected upon the coming into effect of the 1999 Constitution. So is it, if anybody is saying anything otherwise or doing anything otherwise, the person is running against the law. We have a scenario where the system is not democratic and people are running it any way they like because our system allows people who defy the provisions of the law, even the Constitution, to get away with it, even though they are doing it with impunity and with deliberateness. So it's not anything new that should create any excitement that the Supreme Court had given that decision in the manner it did yesterday.
Okay, sir, I hear you, sir, but, you know, there are those who say that the ruling of fiscal autonomy and giving this the local government, giving the local government, you know, the right or the fiscal power for their own fact, there are those who say that it is not constitutional because, for example, yesterday, the former governor of Delta State, I believe, James Ibori, gave out a statement and said a particular section of the Constitution already made it clear that there will be a joint account between, you know, the state government and the local government. So the ruling that, you know, that was given by the justice yesterday, you know, implied or said, not even implied, said that the fund will be now directly to the local government. So he said that is a violation of the Constitution.
Well, he's entitled to his own opinion. I know there is something like a committee on a joint account between the states and the local government, but it doesn't devolve from the fact that the system of a democratically elected local government was guaranteed under the Constitution. There are several ranges of constitutional provisions. There are those provisions that are superior to the other, but there are those that have more effect than the other. The one that is paramount is the one of the fact that the system must be democratic. It has to be democratic first before you talk about a joint account. It is simply that people that take advantage of certain situations to see how they can have their ways, even though they know it's unlawful and it is illegal. That does not make the Supreme Court judgment not being contrary to the provisions of the Constitution. The first anchor of the Constitution, if you are construing it judicially, is when it comes to local government and the local government system, is its democratic nature, which must be first of all established before every other thing happens. If the system in a local government system defies democratic norms, of course, there won't be any need for you to go to other provisions of the Constitution relating to joint account or joint this or joint that. So I don't know where Mr. Ibori is coming from. As far as I know, and as far as the law is concerned, the system must first of all be established in accordance with the provisions of the Constitution. It must function, it must have that sense of democratic responsibility in line with the feature given to it by the Constitution. And that defies its nature and its existence. If that is not existing, of course, you cannot say that a local government is existing. In other words, that a local government that is manned by caretaker committees is not a local government system within the contemplation of the Constitution. You know, so that provision is maybe ancillary to the core provision of Section 7 of the Constitution that guarantees the existence of a democratically elected local government system. The words are mandatory and they must be followed. If you read down that particular provision, Section 7, it says that it shall be run by the laws of states, houses of assembly. But then by virtue of that decision yesterday, you can see that there's a distinction now between the House of Assembly of a state and the local government councils. And that is just essentially to give purpose and to give functionality to the fact that it must be, first of all, democratic. You cannot have a system of that nature being subsumed into the state houses of assembly by their lawmaking powers and made an appendage of the government house of a state and expect that it falls within the confines of a democratically elected local government system as guaranteed under the Constitution.
The argument that the former governor is making is that the subsection, the section 162, subsection 3 of the 1999 Constitution as amended, you know, expressly say that the Federation account shall be distributed among the federal government, state government, and local government. So in fact, the Constitution also implied or stated that the state joint local government account will be paid to the state government.
Now the Constitution can make a provision for something, and judicial interpretation or judicial review can on their own give effects, which will give a better prominence and importance to what the Constitution is saying. It's like just like Chapter 2 on Fundamental Objectives and Directive Principles of State Policy, which says that none of the items under that Chapter 2 shall be justiciable. But recent decisions of the courts, of the Supreme Court, Nikki Toby and the rest of them, have said that those provisions are justiciable, that they come in to supplement the enforceable provisions of the Constitution. So the non-enforceability or non-justiciability of Chapter 2 is now subsumed or anchored, subject to the provision, subject to the pronouncements of the courts. So the Constitution may say one thing, but once the judicial pronouncement is made on a particular provision, on a particular section of that Constitution, even if it affects, even if it is contrary to other provisions, the judicial pronouncement takes effect. That's how the law works. So whatever they are saying, all the other provisions, the Supreme Court has established the intention of the makers of the Constitution to the effect that there must be a democratically elected local government system. Whatever other provisions are saying that does not conform with the judgment of the Supreme Court, then it behoves now on the National Assembly to make an amendment to bring those provisions in conformity with the judicial decision of the Supreme Court. As simple as that.
I agree with you that the role of the Supreme Court is prominent in their interpretation of the Constitution and what, you know, some of those session and subsession, you know, imply. So, but let's move a little bit to the local government chairman, and because our local government chairman across the country, because, you know, maybe we'll talk about this fact that, you know, the local government being given this fiscal, you know, capacity, being allowed to, you know, hold, you know, their own fact and whatnot. Many people say the local government are not really tied by the law. For example, you will see that ICPC, SPFC, or whatnot, you know, don't really go after local government chairman, you know. And so people say this kind of power that is being given to them is very, very open to, you know, abuse of office, abuse of funds. And are there any kind of legal, you know, are there any kind of legal kind of balance, check and balances, you know, on the part of, you know, the government, you know, to put, you know, the local government, local government chairman in check, you know, from a legal standpoint? Are there any kind of legal provisions, you know, to hold them accountable to the funds that have been allocated to them?
I can tell you that there's nothing more abusive of the position of local governments than the position of the governors. They are imposition of power over the running of the state of affairs and the local government areas. They are subsuming the power of local governments into the power of the states. They are total demeaning of the authority of the local government system to function. The local government is not a tier of government. That is well known. At least they exist within states, and the states have found a passion to see how they can run it, either directly or indirectly, to give it some facade of a democratic a democratic nature. The states now conduct elections and do all that, but they are still directly under the control of the state governors and the House of Assembly. But I would say that there's nothing as destructive as what has been done or what is being done by local by governors and state executives and the houses of assembly over the local governments. It has reduced the system to mere appendages of a government house, like I told you earlier, which is totally wrong. And I would say that the judgment of the Supreme Court clears all the fog about the status of local governments and how they should be construed within the ambit of the law and within the ambit of their operational authority. I know very well that there are some constraints over law enforcement on local government chairmen and over accountability and transparency within the system. But the new decision of the court has cleared the fog in that area too, because you interpolate into that decision and you see, if you interpolate into the decision, you see that that cloud has been dispersed, that the local government chairman, who is bequeathed with funds directly from the consolidated revenue fund, must be accountable to whatever is done. And anywhere there's accountability, the law enforcement agents and the anti-corruption bodies, they have the power and the right to investigate. My only concern is the fact that the judgment is not very complete on its own to give them that shade of autonomy that they deserve, because at the end of the day, it's the state electoral commissions that conduct elections to the local government councils, and the state electoral commissions are right in the pockets of the governors. At the end of the day, it's the same garbage in, garbage out, that governors are the ones in charge. They determine who gets in there and who does not, and finally, the funds will still be traceable back, be returned to the governors to expend in the manner they use, because the people at the local government councils, those particularly those of them at the helm of affairs, are stooges of the governors. So it's still the same thing. And some persons are suggesting that the Independent National Electoral Commission should come to conduct elections at the local government councils. To what extent do we give validity to the elections conducted by the local government council?
That's the question I'm
I mean,
about to
by
ask.
the Independent Electoral Commission. Wait, let me finish.
Yes,
To
sir.
what extent do you give validity? So there's total, just as you have lack of transparency in the state Independent Electoral Commissions to conduct local government council elections, there is also that serious, more serious lack of transparency in INEC. INEC has not proven itself in any way to be a credible organization that can be given the saddle of conducting national elections and also local government elections. The first port of call, which it should have, endeared itself and demonstrated its capacity to conduct elections that are free, fair, and credible, has failed totally and completely. So, giving the Independent National Electoral Commissions to conduct elections is just the same thing. It has given the power to whoever is in charge at the federal level to control what happens to local government councils, because it's their own men that gets in there. So it pertains to a vicious cycle of insuperabilities that nobody would want to have in a properly organized system as ours, if you want to take it to that direction. But then accepting, maybe we sit down to ask ourselves questions on how these systems actually function in advanced democracies, in advanced systems, and what it is supposed to be for our people, considering also that the local government system is that the roots and foundation of people power.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much, sir. So what you mentioned just earlier about, you know, the fact that the political structure itself has not really changed in terms of how election will be conducted, in terms of, you know, the power of the local government and things like that. So anyway, well, what I want to mention is that, you know, there's a conversation around minimum wage, right? And there is the federal government, there is the state government saying this is what they want to pay, you know, giving their own revenue, whether it be FARC or IGR or whatnot, you know. And there's also the organized private sector, you know, saying that this is what they can afford to pay. So there's a conversation around that. But now that there will be a kind of slash in the state revenue, you know, because a huge chunk of their revenue comes from the FARC and now it's been directed to the local government. My question would be, you know, it's been stipulated that the responsibility of local government, you know, include, you know, primary health care workers, you know, primary school and whatnot. Will the local government now be part of that conversation, you know, in terms of considering what state can pick? Would there be like a different, you know, minimum wage for state and for local, you know, those who work, you know, within the purview of the local government in terms of the minimum wage, or, you know, would the responsibility fall solely on the state?
In spite of the provisions of the Constitution and the decision of the Supreme Court, which it gave yesterday on local government councils, we will not feign ignorance that the fact that the local governments exist within states. If you look at the Constitution, they are primarily subsumed into states. I know that the Supreme Court is the court of policy, and it took that decision essentially because of the abuse that the chief executives of states and members of the House of Assembly of States have rendered the privilege given to them over the running of local government councils. So the local government council is part of the state. I recall there's a time that we operated a system where the civil service, the civil servants and the local government councils are also seen as civil servants of the state. There won't be much harangue about that over. Are you with me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, I'm here with you, sir. I can hear you.
Are you there with me?
Yes, I am.
Yes. Over whether the local government councils, the council heads will have a choice in determining what should be the minimum wage for its workers. No, I guess it's just the determination of the state government. So when it comes to minimum wage, there's what we call a national minimum wage, because the subnationals or component units have the authority to alter their own outside the realm of the national minimum wage. It's either something like the minimum wage or something close to it. Would maybe the component units, for instance, in the United States, if there's a national minimum wage that's been debated upon by the Congress, you know, and pinned down to a particular amount of money, does a state of Texas or Florida have the power to put it into? We have to look at the legislative list and see who determines the national minimum wage. When chief executives of the subnationals or states come to begin to say, we cannot afford this, we cannot afford that. Because I know that in coming up with the national minimum wage, a lot of issues are considered. The disparity of the strength of some of the states to abide by that as an obligation of states, and all the differentials that exist. But for local government chairman is not at liberty to determine what should be the minimum wage for his for members of the civil servants or those working for the local government councils. It is for the state to determine. And once the state is determined, the councils are bound. So there's no confusion about that at all, as far as I'm concerned.